chief among the publicans, the tax collectors, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was little of stature. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him, and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest with a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, This day is salvation come to this house, for as much as he also is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. And as they heard these things, he added and spake a parable, because he was nigh to Jerusalem, and because they thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. He said, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds, and said unto them, Occupy till I come. But his citizens hated him, and sent a message after him, saying, We will not have this man to reign over us. And it came to pass that when he was returned, having received the kingdom, then he commanded these servants to be called unto him to whom he had given the money, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, Lord, thy pound hath gained 10 pounds. And he said unto him, Well, thou good servant, because thou hast been faithful in a very little, hast thou authority over 10 cities. And the second came, saying, Lord, thy pound hath gained 5 pounds. And he said likewise to him, Be thou also over 5 cities. And another came, saying, Lord, behold, here is thy pound, which I have kept laid up in a napkin. For I feared thee, because thou art an austere man. Thou takest up that thou layest not down, and reapest that thou didst not sow. And he saith unto him, Out of thine own mouth will I judge thee, thou wicked servant. Thou knewest that I was an austere man, taking up that I laid not down, and reaping that I did not sow. Wherefore then gavest not thou money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required mine own usury? And he said unto them that stood by, Take from him the pound, and give it to him that hath 10 pounds. And they say unto him, Lord, he hath 10 pounds. For I say unto you, that unto every one which hath shall be given, and from him that hath not, even that he hath shall be taken away from him. Those mine enemies which would not that I should reign over them, bring them hither and slay them before me. May God add his blessing to that further reading from his word. Grant us all understanding. Psalm 136:1. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. the subject is things that come only from God. There are so many things that come only from God. Well, of course, all things come from God. But there are things that come obviously and directly only from Him. Not through the instrumentality of man, not already provided in the created world, that come from Him. Well, we have many good things from God, and we so often fail to praise Him and thank Him and give Him the glory and the credit for them. But there are many things which we can only obtain from God on application, and that is by applying to Christ's eternal Son for pardon and for forgiveness, by seeking reconciliation with God. And only then can we have certain things. And some of these matters are covered and dealt with in this very remarkable psalm. And it is remarkable. It would long ago have been sung in the ancient temple very frequently. And probably it was a responsive psalm. You can see its structure. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good, for His mercy endureth forever. And the latter part of that verse repeats in every one of the 26 verses. And in all probability, in the temple, the Levite singer would sing the first half, and then the people would respond and sing the second part of each verse. So 26 times, oh, give thanks, for His mercy endureth forever. And that would have been the format. The first three verses in the psalm are the same. They make the same exhortation, and that greatly increases its importance and its power. Verse 2, oh, give thanks unto the God of gods, for His mercy endureth forever. Oh, give thanks, verse 3, to the Lord of lords, for His mercy endureth forever. And they are substantially the same. The great exhortation to give thanks is repeated there at the beginning. Very interesting word in the Hebrew, which is translated give thanks, be thankful, thank Him. It comes from the stretching out of the hand. And of course that is what the Orientals would do in the culture of those days. The gesture of thanksgiving was to raise a hand or stretch out both hands, and this passed into the language. So the word stretch out the hand to God was the term used for giving thanks from the heart. It didn't mean that they always stretched out the hand, but that's how the word was formed and came into use. Give Him thanks. Express relief for things that He has done for you. Express gladness and gratitude. Give Him the credit for all the things that He's done. This is the exhortation, and it repeats continuously through the psalm. Give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good. And in just introducing the psalm, I'd like to mention this, for He is good. How quickly we pass these words over. For He is good. What sense is that meant in there? He is good. Well, in a number of senses, God is good in moral essence. He is perfect. Everything He does is good. Everything He says is true. Everything He says is necessary and accurate and holy and must be said. In moral essence, He is without fault. He is perfect and holy and true. And then again, in being, He is adorable. He is so profound, infinitely profound, and complex, and wonderful. Some while ago, I was reading a biography, a short biography of a great general, and whose reputation was so great and was so esteemed, but his staff officer, his principal staff officer, who was a major who accompanied him all the time and transmitted all his orders and instructions, and discussed everything with him. He knew him very well, and he wrote 2 years later that he had discovered increasingly he was actually an extremely insubstantial man. And he had little conversation of his own, and he had few ideas outside his military know-how and capabilities, and he had little depth, and he had no explanation for the great things of life, and he had nothing to say even to his own family when they encountered tragedy. He came to the conclusion this great man was a relatively empty, shallow man, aside from his great military skills. But I only mention that, and I'm not going to mention names, but I only mention that because the sense in which God is good includes not only his moral goodness, but his richness and his depth and his complexity and his vast arsenal of wisdom and power and goodness. Why, in his word, you see just a little glimpse of the depths of God. If you're talking about a human being, you talk about a certain person maybe as being extremely interesting, extremely profound, full of surprises, a person of substance. If you're fortunate enough to come across such a person, you multiply that many, many times. You're talking about God. He is good in being. He is adorable. He is good in his actions too. In what he does, he is kind, he is gracious, he is loving, he plans for his own, he is caring, he is giving. Oh, the list is so long. That's a third respect in which he is good, in his actions. And he is only good. There is nothing bad in him. He is good in the sense that he is good entirely, 100% perfect, no blemish, nothing to disappoint, nothing to let us down at all. And of course he's good in the sense that he's exclusively good. There is nothing, no one on earth, even remotely good in the sense that God is good. And he's everlastingly good. Just think of the richness of that term, for he is good. And it's in that context that we're called to give thanks, and especially for his mercy, which endures forever. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. So we're going to look quickly at some of these verses tonight to show what we should be giving thanks for and why we should be seeking, every one of us, the God of heaven, the Lord. He is, before I leave that first verse, he is the Lord. You notice it's in capital letters. It's the divine name in the Hebrew that we feebly pronounce Jehovah, the pronunciation only of the initials of the divine name. It's a special name. It means, in effect, the self-existing one. That gives you scope for thought. Only God is self-existing. Only he needs nothing from outside himself. He needs no fuel, he needs no air, he needs no input of energy, no nutrient, nothing that anything or anyone outside of himself can give. He is all-powerful and wholly self-sufficient. In fact, it is from him that everything else comes. All matter, all life flows from him. He is self-existent and eternally divine. The term Jehovah, the Lord, in capital letters in our Bibles, the divine name, the source of all life, all blessing, all power, all authority, he possesses it all. Give thanks unto the Lord. Astonishing that before we converted to God, most of us, give no thanks to him. Give him no credit. He supplies everything. We
We behave as though we owed him nothing. We paid no homage. We showed no interest. Astonishing. You see the richness of the terms by which he's described. Oh, give thanks unto the self-existent, eternal, inextinguishable, all-powerful, all-knowing God, the Holy One, for he is good, morally in every sense, for his mercy, his kindness, his compassions, his goodness, his giving nature is in the Word, endureth forever. He's the one who will live forever, and all who are with him, and know him, and depend upon him, and walk with him. Eternal life is with him, and yet we can be indifferent to all that. So, here we go into some of the verses to teach us some of the things that come only from God. Verse 4, to him who alone doeth great wonders, for his mercy endureth forever. Very quickly, I explain. Great wonders. He created all things from nothing. He brought everything into being. He's provided us with everything that we're aware of and that we have. He's provided us with life itself. Here we are, alive. We have consciousness. We have appreciation. We can enjoy things and appreciate things and love things. We can have pleasures, pleasurable sensations and thoughts and friends. All these astonishing and extraordinary things, life and consciousness, come from him. He made it all. Great wonders. When you think of vision and the capacity to see astonishing things, and to see friends and loved ones, God has given it all. To give thanks to him, to praise him for it, well, his mercy endureth forever. Which means two things. His door is open. We can tell him our faults. We can repent before him. We can cast ourselves before him and say, Lord, I haven't thanked thee. I haven't credited thee. I haven't thought of these things. I've behaved as if I've made them for myself. And I have these powers and capacities of life by my own skill or devising. And I have ignored thee and I've given nothing to thee. Lord, forgive me. His compassions, his mercies endure forever. And in a second thought, I had better know him. I had better begin to thank him. I had better begin to relate to him. Because only he can enable me to live forever. Only he can give eternal life. If I am to be included in those who live eternally in the next life, who know him and walk with him, he is the one who has, whose mercies endure forever. I had better come to him. So he alone does great wonders. And then verse 5, to him that by wisdom made the heavens, for his mercy endureth forever. His wisdom made the skies, the universe with its immensity and its vastness. That should make us think. It's not good enough to look into the skies and to just wonder at their greatness and to be impressed occasionally by the starry skies. You get outside the city and you can see them. You get a sense of awe and a sense of power. It's necessary to let these things humble you. There is a God, there is a designer, there is a creator, there's a vast expanse, how small I feel. I owe him my life, my all. I'm so trivial and so small before him. I shouldn't live without him, the creator of vastness and greatness. And infinity and
things, to him that by wisdom made the heavens, for his mercy endureth forever. It's time to go to him and to tell him your faults and your wrong, that you've never accepted that humbly, and you've lived as a very proud, disdainful person. And yet, there is that vast sky, the vastness of the universe, should have put us in our place and humbled us and put us into a more seeking frame. But his mercy endureth forever, and he will forgive, and he will give you love. Look at verse 6. To him that stretched out the earth above the waters. What does that make you think of? Well, he made the land masses for people to live on and survive and have life and pursue their life on this earth. He provided and he gave all these things, the land masses. Yes, that makes me think, how could I live without what God has provided? I breathe his air. I eat the food that the land provides. I give him no thanks. Effectively, I steal it all. I behave as though it's mine by right. I give no gratitude, no credit, no praise to the one who has given all these things. It's time for me to repent and to thank him and seek him and have eternal life. For his mercy endureth forever. He will forgive me, and I'll tell you how in a moment. Look at this in verse 7. To him that made great lights, for his mercy endureth forever. Well, yes, everybody enjoys the benefit of the sun and its gravitational football, the stability of the universe, and the light and the warmth and the supply of energy. These things come from God alone. Man endlessly tries to explain them without God. I did that once. How pitiful, how sad. And we fire off these highly advanced spaceships and so on into the atmosphere, and then we read in the press, oh, something else has been launched to land in such and such a place, to gather information, to tell us about the origin of the earth. In a sense, it's so sad. There is a creator, all the evidence of design. But mankind, in determined unbelief, is like throwing pebbles into the sea, is hurling tiny objects measured against creation. Tiny objects into space, into the air, in the vain hope that we'll find some explanation for it all other than God the Lord. What a tragedy it all is to him that made great lights. And we shall thank him and praise him. But also in the Bible, the great lights, some particularly, they are used figuratively, not just to describe literal light and energy and heat and so on, but to describe spiritual light and knowledge and understanding. To him that made the greatest light of all, which is not after all the sun. It's the scriptures. It's the revelation of God that we were talking about last week, delivered into this world, telling us about God, telling us about ourselves and our need, telling us about the way of salvation. To him that made great lights, yes, sun, moon, stars, but the greatest light of all, the revelation of information about God and about salvation. And it's possible we hadn't even considered it. And we do not rate it. And we do not look to it. Publication of Almighty God, inspired by him, delivered through the ages, that can give us the way to heaven and forgiveness and reconciliation with himself. That's the provision. You can only know God's truth and understand the meaning of life and God's plans and purposes by coming to that greatest light of all. But you can. You've despised him? Yes, but his mercy endures forever. He is a forgiving God, and he will give you light, and he will bring you to eternal life. Again, we'll mention how in just a moment. He describes, verse 8, the psalmist, the sun to rule by day. Verse 9, the moon and stars to rule by night. Yes, and the moon and stars in Scripture also are figures for a different kind of light. When you are in night, and you don't know which way to go, where to turn, where life is taking you, when you're beset by troubles, or you're confused, and you want direction, and you want guidance, then you can obtain it from God. If you know him, you can pray to him. He will guide you through his word, the Bible. He will guide you by bringing your mind to life and helping you consider all the issues. He will have his help, and you'll be sharper and have greater insight than you ever would have had before you learned to pray and before you came to him. But sometimes he'll overrule your life and intervene in an unmistakable, circumstantial manner. The moon and the stars, the sun in Scripture speaks of spiritual lights, the Scriptures, and the moon and the stars, that guidance that you need in night times of life. And then verse 10, to him that smote Egypt in their firstborn, he's a delivering God. He delivers people even in their earthly circumstances and gives them great relief, escapes from danger, illnesses that fight the life out of them, and a cure when you get better. Sometimes God isn't thanked. There's no praise or thanksgiving to him for his overruling goodness. What a tragedy. But his mercy endures forever. He'll forgive us if we come to him, and he'll give us eternal life. I go down to verse 12. With a strong hand and with a stretched out arm, he delivered his people. And he delivers us spiritually like that. Supposing I'm a person who never thinks about God, and I was one time, years ago, utterly lost and benighted. And supposing I'm such a person, I never think of him, and never praise him, never thank him, never look to him, never learn of him, never yield to him or obey him. Yes, how will God change all that? How will he deliver me? With a strong hand, says the Scripture, marvelous things will happen. He will move in my heart so that I see my sin and I repent before him and I trust in Christ, who's the Savior who came to die for sinners and pay the punishment and the price in our place. And I'll trust in him and he'll change my life and he'll give me a new nature and make me a different person and relate me to himself so that I can praise him and know him and have his touch upon my life with a strong hand and with a stretched out arm, for his mercy endureth forever. You come to him, he will receive you. That's what this psalm says over and over again. And if in your mind you get the thought, well, supposing I repent of my indifference to God, and I come to him as a sinner and I trust in Christ, who suffered and died for a person like me, if I trust in him, will he receive me? Will I experience that change in my soul and in my life? Can I be sure of his mercy? Yes, you can, says this psalm, 26 times, for his mercy endureth forever. Don't you see, those words are a kind of warrant of faith, like possessing a car.
or a ticket which gets you in to some special place that you never get into without that authority that you hold in your hand. Is there an authority which will assure me that God will hear my repentance and my prayer and save me? Yes, in this one psalm, 26 times. For his mercy, his compassion, his kindness endure forever. And we could look at other verses, but my time is almost out, so I come down to verse 23. Who remembereth us in our lowly estate, for his mercy endureth forever. He looks down from on high and he marks people, notices them, sets his eye upon them, and he pities them for their low estate. What's that? My condemned state. I've sinned my life away, and I deserve only the rejection and condemnation of God. He sees me so ignorant of God. This is before I'm converted. So ignorant. So unaware of the way of salvation. So brainwashed by unbelieving things. He sees me polluted in guilt. I've done so many things which are deeply offensive to God. I've broken the Ten Commandments. I've sinned against him year after year. I've been proud and deceitful and wretched and spurned him and given him nothing, no praise, no credit, no love, no worship. I'm deeply polluted in his sight and I have no hope. My low estate, I cannot improve myself. I cannot make up for my terrible record of offensiveness to God. Such gifts of goodness and kindness that I've shown are so outweighed by all that is wrong. And he pities people in their low estate. Verse 23, who remembered us in our low, low estate. For his mercy, his compassion, his kindness, his readiness to forgive, endureth forever. And verse 24, and hath redeemed us from our enemies. Who are your enemies? With your condemnation, like a sword of Damocles hanging over your head. You go to the end of life and into judgment with this sin record and guilt record. It's an enemy. Satan, the devil, the enemy of souls, is your enemy. He's brought you away from God every step of life's journey, and he'll keep you away from him. He'll claim you eternally, who hath redeemed us from our enemies. Christ came and purchased a vast number of people. People who would be turned to him, to trust in him. And he went to Calvary's cross. And there God put upon him all the guilt of those who would ever be forgiven, past, present, and future, and punished him instead of them. And in terrifying and terrible moments, the eternal Son, who was God and man, suffered the consequences of our sin, that punishment that we deserved forever and forever, somehow contracted and compacted into a matter of hours, and he bore it all away. And that's the oblique reference of the verse here, verse 24, and hath redeemed us, purchased us back from our enemies. For his mercy endureth forever, who giveth food to all flesh. Verse 26, oh, give thanks unto the God of heaven, the God of eternity, the God who gives eternal life,
for his mercy endureth forever, asking for forgiveness. Trust only in what Christ has done on Calvary's cross. It has come to you as a free gift. You cannot secure it by any deserving of your own. Ask for communion with God, a new nature, a new life. Give yourself entirely over to him. Give all that debt of thanks that is piled up for life, and most of all, for forgiveness and salvation. Give it to him. Oh, give thanks unto the God of heaven, for his mercy endureth forever. This is an appeal to our souls, dear friends. This is an exhortation from the Psalms. This is a warning also. What will become of us if we do not come to him and give him our thanks and our homage and seek that forgiveness that he gives? And it's a warrant of faith from Almighty God. Glorious words. Oh, give thanks unto the God of heaven, for his mercy endureth forever. Let's pray. Thank you.